Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison for GI. Thank you very much for joining me once again on a Monday evening where we do the thing we do every Monday evening, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. Today, we are continuing our series on practice strategies. Specifically today, we're going to be talking about introducing random elements into your practice sessions and why it is beneficial and how you might do it and some very, very cheap and affordable and dare I say everyday objects that might help with this process of slightly randomizing your practice. We're also going to be taking your questions and answering them in the Q&A a little later in this stream. So we've got all sorts of good stuff for you. First of all, though, let's check in with the comments. I'm going to apologize ahead of time. For whatever reason, my mouse has decided to become extremely unresponsive tonight. So if you see me getting very frustrated with the technology at my end, that's what it is. Blame Apple. Blame Apple for everything. So let's just check in with the stream. Let's see who's in. We got some friends tuning in already. Ian Taylor is well early. Ian tuned in at 7:30, no less, 30 minutes early. Ian, thanks for joining us. Great to have you. Our friend Blue Sumlin is in and he's dropping the questions already. We're going to be answering your question in just a moment. My good man, thank you so much for joining us. Marcine is in from Rome this evening, a world traveler, no less. Cool. Mark is tuning in from Idaho. Mark, it's great to have you. Philippe is back from France, if I remember rightly, last week. Yes, hi, third round, says Philippe. Snowblind, a first-time commenter, if I'm not mistaken, from Liverpool, a beautiful city. I love Liverpool. Just always have a real kinship with people from Liverpool. Maybe it's a Geordie Scouser thing, I don't know. But I remember being, just a quick anecdote, I remember being sat at the Martin Guitars dinner in, it was in LA at the NAMM show, rather in Anaheim, at the NAMM show. We're at the Grand Legacy in Anaheim, which is the big Disney hotel out there. And all the guys from Martin had recently learned what a Scouser was. And they were trying to work out if I was one and why I wasn't one. And they were going, so is that what you are? Because we know there are like posh English people and there are London English people. And now we know there are Scousers. So if you're not a Scouser, then what are you? And I had to explain to them how the UK accent system works. But yeah, great city. Love playing there. Had some great, great times in Liverpool. Pete C is from my neck of the woods. He's tuning in once again. It's great to have you. Another friend of mine, Darren Wall. I'm guessing it's the same Darren Wall. Don't get many Darren Walls to the pound. Darren is, again, a good friend. Taking some lessons with me in the past. Fabulous guitar player. Who else do we have? Matt says, hi, Nick. Matt, it is great to have you on board. Bert is tuning in from Burlington, New York in the good old USA, fantastic part of the universe. And our friend Jason is tuning in from Cornwall, beautiful, beautiful part of the country. If you're tuning in from somewhere outside of the UK, it's the very, very bottom tip. It's basically the opposite end of the UK, of England to me. I'm in the very north, the very northeast corner. This side, as you look at it, Cornwall is kind of down here, the very, very southwest end. But again, bit of a kinship with the Cornish. I feel like Geordie's, Cornwall, yeah, it's one of those things. Anyway, so we digress. We're talking about places that we're from. If you are just tuning in, by the way, do drop us a comment and let us know where you're tuning in from. I also want to cast your ears on something. So a quick question for you. I'm going to be playing with a couple of different tones tonight and I'll make a point of A being them. And there's only really one thing that's different, but I want your opinions on whether you guys prefer tone A or tone B. So do let me know in the comments. Here, just for quick reference, here is tone A. Here is tone B, just to show you what I'm talking about. I'm just experimenting with some things at my end. So here's tone B. So a little more high end, a little less in the mid range on tone B. You guys hear what's going on. I'll be playing with those over the course of the evening and I'll just be checking in and seeing what you guys prefer. So if you have a preference, do let me know. Also, once again, if you have questions, drop them in the comments because I would love to answer them in the Q&A and it gives me a bit of a chance to think about my answer as well. So all of that stuff. We already have some comments. Tone B is winning so far. All right, cool. Well, we're going to keep we're going to keep on that one. Tone B says Blue Sumlin. Interesting, interesting. Okay, cool. Well, right, tone B is unanimous so far, but we'll try it in a mix and we'll see if there's a difference there. Wow, everybody wants tone B. That is impressive. Okay, cool. Right, we'll come back to that in a moment. So on with the subject today. Ooh, before I forget, if you haven't done so already, best ways you can support this stream. If you're finding these streams useful and you're getting some information out of it that you're finding useful in your own playing or even just some entertainment on a Monday night, best thing you can do is you can give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching on. If you're on Facebook, hearts do very, very well. Thumbs up on YouTube, hit the like button. That does very, very well indeed. You can also subscribe to the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel where we post free backing tracks, all the good stuff. And of course, last but not least, the best thing you can do to support this stream is to check out GI Plus. GI Plus is, of course, the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive magazine, which I will be telling you all about later on. But there is a link in the description for you to check that out yourself. So anyway, now that my mouse has decided to start playing ball again, let's get into the meat of the stream, which is the idea of introducing some variability and some randomness into your practice. Now, when I say variability, and when I say randomness, it's important to know kind of what I'm talking about here. This is what I probably consider controlled randomness rather than absolute randomness. Because to be honest, we're all a bit guilty of being very scattergun with our practice approach and saying, well, you know, I'm just going to sit down and play whatever I feel like. And there is some merit to that, as we've discussed in the past. But if you're trying to develop a very specific thing or a set of specific skills, then variability is a really great way to certainly develop motor skills, but also to develop your musical skills. The reason for this is, especially with the motor skills development thing, is one of the ways that we learn as human beings, as like variable, adaptable biological organisms, is through solving problems. And solving problems that are closely related to the problem we're trying to solve. So, for example, if we go to the close-up camera real quick, if I was trying to get better at playing, let's say I'm going to crack that old nut of more independence between fingers 3 and 4. Let's say I was trying to get better at that. Now, what I could do is I could just play fingers 3 and 4 over and over again like this. And that would work to an extent, but by introducing a little bit of variation into what it is I'm trying to do with fingers 3 and 4, I actually get better at the skill of playing between fingers 3 and 4. Let me show you what I'm talking about. So an example of variation in this sense would be if instead of just playing fingers 3 and 4, maybe what I did was I played fingers 1, 2, 3, 4 and then played 3, 4, 3, 4 like this. Now, what I'm doing there is I'm introducing some variation between this simple, like, 3-4-3-4-3-4 exercise. It's still very heavily weighted towards the idea of fingers 3 and 4, but by introducing a little bit of variation, what I might do, or what I'm doing is essentially, is I'm kind of forcing myself to solve a problem. A mechanical problem in this instance, or like a motor problem, but there are other problems we can solve. So for example, musical problems, which are also going to improve your capability on the instrument. So let's do another one. Let's say, for example, I played that and it was starting to feel pretty good. What I could do is instead of playing 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, 3, 4, I could change it to 1, 2, 4, 3, 4, 3, 4, 3, which would give me this. And then I could play between them, so I could set it so that I played 3-4-3-4 on one string and then 4-3-4-3 on the next string, like this. And so on and so forth. Now, by introducing this variability of movement into my practice, I'm not saying be totally random with this, by the way. I would spend a bit of time with each of these exercises. I'd maybe spend, you know, 5 minutes on each one before I really start to vary it. But by introducing this variability from session to session, and also within the session, I'm presenting novel problems to the part of my brain that deals with this motor control. So that is kind of one of the ways we can introduce variability. But it also sort of begs the question, how do we decide how to vary things? Well, I'm going to encourage you to invest in some dice. Now, the reason we choose dice is because dice are a very easily transportable analog, i.e. you don't need to use an app or anything, easily transportable random way of generating numbers. So what you're going to need is you're going to need a typical six-sided dice, which I have here, and you're also going to need one of these guys. This is a four-sided dice, which you may or may not have seen. It's a four-sided dice, little triangle guy there, and I just bought this literally this week because I gave my last one away to one of my students. So I bought it this week just so I could show you guys on this stream. Now, the reason we choose six and we choose four, we need a six-sided dice and a four-sided dice, should be fairly obvious to you, because for most guitars, we have six strings, and most of us have four fingers. So we can generate a whole lot of randomness with just a six-sided dice and a four-sided dice. Let's demonstrate. So we're going to begin by rolling a six-sided dice. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to generate two strings. So let's start. For argument's sake, I'm going to see what we get. So we get string number two and string number four. Okay, so I have B string and I have the D string. This has generated two random strings for me. So what I'm going to do is I am now going to spend a bit of time improvising using just these strings. So what I have here is a limitation that's being put on me by the dice. They've just been just the gods of fate have chosen that today I'm going to play on string two and string number four. And to make it even more kind of like, well, let's say a little more constrained, I'm going to focus on just playing the minor pentatonic scale. I'll be playing in C. So what that gives me, all told, if I start in my box position, it means instead of playing this, what I might get is this. There are my options. Here are some more options. Here are some more options. And then I have options here. So a few options are available to me, but I don't have access to all of my typical licks that I would play. So what I'm going to do first of all is I'm going to start doing what I'd call an exploration session. So this is an exploration session where I would literally just explore the minor pentatonic in the key of C and see what comes out. Let's put that same back track on. This is a blues rock track in C. I'm just going to throw that on there if I can make it work. The dice have presented me with two pretty unusual strings there, but it's interesting because I'm coming out with some lines that maybe I wouldn't necessarily have played before, but also there are lines that I'm expecting to play that I can hear, like for example this line right here. That is now quite difficult to play because I don't have access to the G string. So I can't play all of these stock lines that I'm used to playing. But what it means is it's kind of forcing me to be a little more conscious about what it is that I'm trying to do. So let's put this into a practical situation. Let's say, for example, that you, as a guitar player, are struggling to navigate the five box positions of the pentatonic scale. Well, let's grab our dice and let's keep rolling. And what I'm going to do is I'm basically going to set myself the task of only playing the minor pentatonic scale on the string that the dice give me. So when I feel like I'm a little bit sick and I feel like I'm kind of getting some, not getting into a rut, but I'm kind of bumping up against the, you know, I feel like I've kind of done everything I can do with that particular string, I'll roll the dice again and generate another string. And if it comes up with the same string, I'm going to stick with it. So let's throw that track back on. I'm going to roll some dice and let's see what happens. First of all, one string. Let's see what we get. E string. Easy. So we're going to start with the first string. So what I'm doing here is I'm trying to navigate my box positions in the pentatonic scale. Only on one string. So I feel like I'm getting the hang of that, so let's get ourselves another string. Let's see what happens. One again, so I'll play a little more on one. Let's see what else we get. So let's go string three, G string. A little bit of habit crept in there. Reach for that high E string. Now that's interesting because I'm going to pause there and talk about that because this is part of the game here. So we are somewhat gamifying your practice by doing this, but while there are rules, it's not like super rigid rules where if you deviate from them, you lose. Kind of think about them more as very, very strong guidelines rather than absolute rules per se. A little bit of music theory in that regard. Think about it as strong guidelines rather than rules. So, but we'll get onto that discussion another time. The plurality of music theories and the idea of the map not being the territory, etc. It's another story for another day. But basically what I'm saying here is I noticed a little habit where when I hit this lick, I reached immediately out of habit for my high E string. Now that's interesting because what that tells me is I've developed an association over time with this little phrase right here, and it's become instinctive. So it's almost become automatic that when I play here, I will subsequently follow on and play here. Now that is kind of cool because it's a lick that I like, but it's also given me something to be wary of because, you know, we don't want to play the same stuff over and over again. It's cool to have signature licks and all that good stuff, but, you know, we don't want to be repeating ourselves all the time. So that's interesting. I'm going to make a mental note of that as I go on. So anyway, that's how we might use dice to generate string groups. But what about our four-sided dice for fingers? Because there's some interesting stuff to be done here as well. Now, it's not just for fingers. We can also use our four-sided dice for rhythm ideas, which is another story for another day. But I'd like your suggestions. So if I gave you a four-sided dice and said to you, hey, generate me some random practice, some random thing, random element to my practice, what would you give me? So what would you tell me to do? And I'll do it for you guys because, you know, we're all about taking risks on these streams. You've seen me make plenty of mistakes by now. They're not mistakes. They're just Bob Ross style happy accidents because guitar players make mistakes. And we are suspicious of people who will tell you that they never make mistakes because everyone makes mistakes. And I don't believe in hiding my mistakes from you guys, at least. Anyway, so although I'm editing a live album right now and I am really thinking about hiding some mistakes, but that's another story for another day. So anyway, I've got my own ideas, but you tell me in the comments what you would do with this dice. I'm going to start, however, with a little drill where I'm going to outlaw one of my fingers. So one of my fingers off the table, not allowed to use it anymore. This is an improvisation thing. So this is more of a vocabulary building thing. We'll do something on technical ideas in a moment, but I'm going to roll my four-sided dice and we'll see what comes up. Finger four, that's boring because everyone can play without finger four. So I'll do another one. Keep saying finger four. Let's pick another one. Finger one. Wow. There you go. Tempt the gods of fate and they will punish you. So finger one. So what I'm going to do now, my four-sided dice has told me that finger one is now outlawed. So that's fine. I'm now going to try and play without using finger one and I'm going to see what happens. So feel free to roast me if I just drop loads of finger ones in here or if I'm terrible by contrast. Now what I might do, actually here's a thought, just talking about tools for the job, what I might do just to make it extra important that I don't use finger one or extra locked in stone is I might take my slide and I might just put it on finger one. I don't normally wear my slide on finger one, but maybe I'll just put it there just so, you know, so as a reminder not to use this finger. Maybe I won't. I'm going to see how it feels, but let's just try it and we'll see what happens. So blues rock, no finger one. This could be interesting. Here we go. Man, this is hard. I'm going to take this thing off because that's just getting a bit cumbersome, but I'll try not to use finger one. Ooh, that's hard. Ha! That's tough. So, that's tough, but it's deliberately tough, right? The reason that it's tough is because I'm taking away a finger that I wouldn't normally use. So the dice have, hey, Chris Davies is in the stream. Chris is a longtime friend of the channel. Chris, hey, it's good to have you. Thanks for joining us. So yeah, reason I've taken my finger one away again is because, for anybody's just tuning in now, because I rolled a dice and the dice told me, hey, no finger one. And that's okay, because it's given me a framework that's taken away some of my my stock licks. So I'm really having to think about what it is that I'm playing, and I'm really challenged from a motor skill perspective, because I'm having to reach for things with my other fingers that I wouldn't normally reach for. Now, this is quite unpleasant to sit and do, and as you can hear, it does have a negative impact on how good you sound, but that's the idea. That's the whole point with this. Now, it's not to, let me be very clear about this, it's not some way of making your other fingers more independent or anything like that. What it is it's a way of reinforcing the skill learning aspect of playing the guitar. So when you take away one of these fingers and you're forced to solve these problems, all your other fingers get better, including finger one, because playing guitar is not about four individual players on a team acting separately from each other. It's you are one being, you're one, you know, one human organism, or in the case of our friend I Love Pancakes, a pancake organism, I'm guessing. I don't know. Hey, it's great to have you on board. Thanks for joining us. I also love pancakes. Yeah, you're one human organism who is playing the guitar, and by, like I say, by presenting yourself with these randomized challenges, you are getting more of that good motor skill learning. So let's do another. Let's take another finger out and we'll see what happens. So what does the dice say? The dice says finger four. It really wants me to play without finger four, so I'm just going to do it, right? Because we've had four finger fours in a row and it doesn't behoove me to overlook that. It's no good just to say, hey, you know, oh, let's just, the dice says finger four, but that's boring, so I'm going to do another one. I'm just going to do it. So here we go. Same deal. No finger four. Finger four came out. Interesting. Interesting. Spotted a habit there. Oh, it did it again. Now, this is interesting because that finger four practice, the finger four list practice, is that I did a fair bit of, trying to get my shred stuff on the go with finger, without finger four, so I can play slide with finger four and still do some shreddy stuff, so I could. So on and so forth. Now, a little bit musicalist demonstration, you guys get the gist. So, you get the gist of how that works, but let's talk about some other aspects that you might randomize. So what are some other things in your playing that you can think of that you would consider randomizing with, again, the use of our dice. So we've randomized string choices. We've randomized fingers. What about rhythm? Can we randomize rhythm? Well, yeah, we can. So let's take the idea of the dice and let's use it as a subdivision randomizer. So we have four-sided dice. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, which is how many notes per beat I'm going to play. Or is it? There are some other subdivisions we can choose too, but I'll let you think about that while I'm playing this one. So drop your answer in the comments. I'd love to know what it is. Oh no, I've dropped my dice. I'd love to know what it is that you would do with this. So I'll show you some ideas of my own, but then we'll explore some more stuff. So also, if you are enjoying the live stream, drop us a comment, drop us a like, you know what to do. Or drop us a live, as it says. I think I've typed that wrong, but never mind. That's neither me, well, I'm playing guitar and typing at the same time, so hey. You gotta let me off. Anyway, right, randomizing some rhythms. So I'm gonna randomize the amount of notes that I'm playing in a given beat. So for argument's sake, just to show you what I'm talking about, if I was playing one note per beat, my rhythm was like this, I'd be playing quarter notes. Two notes per beat, eighth notes. Triplets, three notes per beat, 16th notes. Ah, Darren's come up with a good one, intervals. Oh, very spicy. We're going to do something on that in a moment. So maybe some interval targeting is a really good idea, which we're going to randomize. But I'm going to randomize subdivisions. So let's start with two. Cool. I'm going to limit myself to playing just two notes per beat. Ah, Felipe's come up with a good one. A chord progression. Fantastic. You could absolutely come up with a randomized chord progression with some dice. If you wanted to solo over some chords, that'd be a fantastic way to do things. So what you could do, here's an idea. Just randomize a chord progression real quick. So let's say, for example, we took a six-sided dice and we used that to randomize a collection of notes. So randomizing a chord progression. Oh, they're all coming in. Everybody's got some great ideas. So, but we're going to randomize a chord progression. Let's say we roll our six-sided dice and that gives us a letter name. Let's say, it doesn't really matter. Let's say we take, we could do an eight-sided dice. We could do 12-sided dice and pick some, or we could roll... No, we couldn't roll two dice because you can't get a one on two dice, but you get the idea. So we could do, a six-sided dice or an eight-sided dice or 12-sided dice, whatever, and you could randomly pick a chord based on your one of these. But this could give you major 7, minor 7, dominant 7, alter dominant. So you could do, let's say, blah, 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 blah. So that's going to give me an... what is that? That's a, haven't even established a root, but that's six. So, ooh, I don't know. Let's say I'm an E and randomly six will be C sharp. So I'll pick another one. And randomly I would get like, what have I got? Let's give me four. So that'd be A. And let's give them values. So C sharp dominant to A. It's a bit obvious. A major seven. Let's do another one. Oh, A alter dominant. So randomized chord progression. C sharp dominant 9. A. A alter dominant. I have to solo over the top of that. Tough. It's quite difficult trying to play something musical without the chords behind me. Very challenging. Ah, Bert answered the question. Always thought English musicians describe divisions as minims, crotchets, etc. Yeah, we do, as a rule of thumb, or we're meant to anyway. But personally, this is maybe just me, I think that system is very silly. Very, very silly indeed. When the American system is perfectly useful and way more descriptive. In my opinion. True story, by the way. Did you know that? You've probably seen this in a video by Adam Neely, where he talks about the idea of a minim, which we think of as half note in like American parlance. So we think of it as half note. It was once considered to be the minimum length of music because music is an arms race, and somehow we've ended up with hemi-demi-semi-quavers. Quaver was originally basically just like, just play these notes really, really fast, like a quavering sound. It's really, really interesting. Roy Lisbon says, 64 triplets over Yeah, over 310. There is one place in the world that happens, Roy, and it's on the internet. Normally some guy's got a clock behind him going, I am playing Flight of the Bumblebee. It's like, nobody cares, bro. Maybe I'm being too cruel, but you get the idea. Interesting one here. And which beat of the bar to accent? Ooh, we could do that. Or we could also do something on which subdivision of the beat to accents. Let's do all of these, right? So we've randomized a chord progression. That's good fun. I can't remember what I rolled, so I'm going to roll again. 3. Cool. All right, so triplets. I'm going to throw my blues rock. In fact, I'm sick of this blues rock track. Let's do the ambient ballad in E major, and I'm going to play triplets over this. So the dice said triplets. Triplets it is. Key of E major. We're going to get something like this. With slow triplets. Here's a cool one. Pete's got one. Note groupings. Interesting. Well, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to stick with triplets. I'm going to use the 4-sided dice to tell me the rhythm. I'm going to use the 6-sided dice to tell me the groupings. So let's see. Fives. Groupings of 5 in 2 notes per beat. So ba, 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 ba. 8 notes. Interesting. Let's see what happens. Okay. No. There's my rhythm. Ooh. A bit lost there. Very cool. That's a line that I want to develop. So what I do now, what I do at this point, is if I found a line I wanted to develop, I would go, found something. So I'm going to develop it. I'm going to play. So what I might do, that business. I just start getting rid of the boundaries and just develop that line. Because that's something cool that I want in my play. There it is. That's really nice. We're peeling behind the curtain a little bit there. And I will say, you absolutely have license to do this. If you find something cool with these randomizations of things, then man, you should absolutely 100% just like go off script, go off program, and like take some time to develop the idea, because that's what we're here to do, for argument's sake. So let's go a little deeper with this. So there's been some suggestions about accents. Accents are a really great way to do this. So what we could do here is we could randomize which of the 16th notes on our beat we're going to do, because we have a 4-sided dice, so we could do this. That's 1, that's boring. 3, yeah, we can do 3. That's the offbeat. So if our 16th is ba 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 ba, we're going to go ba 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 ba. There's our accent. So let's not just accent, let's just phrase that. Making an accent, so I'm going to accent all my phrases. I'll start and finish on that part of the beat. So let's go. 2, 3. Let's do another one. Let's pick another part of the beat. Oh, two. This is going to be interesting. So, second 16ths. Okay, let's do some phrasing onto that rhythm. So let's go. Didn't mean to. Can I land this? Yeah! First time for everything. Fantastic. Great. So there we go. So that's some improvisation stuff. But before we get into the Q&A, is there any technical stuff we can do with this? Well, yes. Let's throw our close-up camera back on. What if we were back to doing our technical exercise? So let's say our technical exercises might be something like this guy. Oh, we talked about this idea where we played. Oh, what was it now? It was 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, 3, 4. 1, 2, 4, 3, 4, 3, 4, 3, which is already nightmarish. But what about if we accented a particular finger? Oh, let's just throw that out there. So, and accent a particular finger, finger two. That's quite easy. So let's throw a clean sound on, see what we get. Clean sound, accenting finger two. I'm just gonna turn my compressor off actually, because my clean sound comes bundled with the compressor because I use this live, and sometimes you just wanna hack at the guitar and don't wanna take people's ears out when you're playing clean. So, accenting fingers two. Nice. Let's find a harder finger. Finger one. Okay, finger one's quite easy, but I'll do finger one and... No, we're going to ignore that. So let's... finger three. Wow, okay, that's going to be tough. So accenting finger three. Oh, again. Wow, that's hard. Now, what's interesting here again is this kind of variability that we've got going on here, again, is so important to your motor learning. There's nothing worse than just having a single lick that you maybe just practice over and over again, and that's your lick, or a single scale that you practice over and over again, or a particular picking pattern, because you get diminishing returns from these things once you start to get good at them. So we take the example of the Paul Gilbert lick, which everybody plays all the time. This guy, which I'm going to be so bold as to play clean, and then hit the G string. Ooh, there's some little scraps in there. Let's try that again. And so on and so forth. Now, I'm about to rag on that leg, but clearly I need to practice that a little bit more. Or practice something a little bit more anyway. But there's nothing worse than having a lick and you go, oh, that's my lick. I play the lick all the time because, you know, you kind of get stuck in these mechanical ruts and then you don't get any better. And if you'd be wondering why your technique doesn't get any better, it's because you're not presenting challenges to yourself. So randomization in your practice, great way to challenge yourself. Some quick notes, by the way, if you're enjoying the backing tracks that you're hearing in these streams, you can get them all for free on the GI YouTube channel. It's a playlist, link in the comments, which has all of the backing tracks in them. We're adding them every week. New backing track every week. This week, we just dropped the, or rather on Friday, just gone, we just dropped the backing track from the now infamous Blues Jam with Tom Quayle, where I managed to convince Tom to play blues. So that was a thing. Turns out Tom's really good at playing blues, even though he kind of tells us all that he's not. Maybe it's not like, you know, I don't know, maybe Tom has a different definition of good to the rest of us, which wouldn't surprise me, to be fair. But Tom Quayle, turns out, fabulous blues player. Who knew? And literally, we sat down to jam. We had about 20 minutes before I had to go. And I was like, you know, let's roll the cameras, we'll play something. And I went, hey, what do you want to play? And he went, anything but blues. I'm like, oh man, I have this cool blues backing track. Put it on. Tom aced it and frightened the life out of me, because he always does. So that track is now available on the GI YouTube channel, but there's a bunch of others too. Also, if you want to get them ad-free, you can go to GI Plus, which is the lesson platform on Guitar Interactive magazine, and you can get them free. You don't even need to be a member. So that's how much we like you guys. You can get them free and just watch them ad-free, no adverts, no interruptions, on GI Plus. However, if you do decide to sign up for GI Plus, the membership is ludicrously cheap for the amount of cool stuff you get. We're also going to give you the option to download them. And you can download them, you can keep them forever, use them for whatever evil intent you may have. So use them in your own music, use them for your own videos. Actually, somebody has already used one in his own music. Some guy downloaded the Whitesnake 87 ballad backing track. And then decided to release it as a single and then copyright strike us, which was hilarious. And he's not even a member. And I know this because we hadn't even reduced that perk at that point. But if he was a member, I'd probably just let him have it. But anyway, so this very quickly is GI Plus. I'm just going to show you guys this. You've seen it all before. And then we're going to take your questions. So drop your questions in the comments. Let me know what it is you guys want to talk about. Drop your questions below and I will do my best to answer them. But first, this right here, this is GI Plus. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today. There you go, that's GI Plus. You can check out all of that good stuff at this link in the comments. There's also a link in the description of this video where you can find out more. Again, you'll get all the back tracks for free, even if you're not a member, and they are ad-free as opposed to YouTube, which does tend to, it's got a bit too comfortable with like 2-minute long adverts. Maybe that's just me. I'm one of those suckers that, I mean, you know, not suckers, but one of those people that signed up for YouTube Premium, and I do not miss those ads. Let me tell you, when I have to use something, you have to use somebody else's account, it drives me crazy. So much ad. So yeah, you can get the ads, you can get the videos ad-free on GI Plus, or if you just want to do them on YouTube, you can get the backing tracks at this link. So let's get onto some questions. Oh, also some things we've added this week. We're adding, we've added all of Tom Quayle's development professional technique lessons. We're also adding Sam Bell's new course on heavy metal rhythm guitar, which I will tell you all about another time. Expect an email in your inbox about that quite soon. If you're not signed up to our mailing list, by the way, make sure you are. You can do that at the Guitar Interactive website, www.guitarinteractivemagazine.com. So let's get into some questions. First question, what looper pedal would you recommend? Okay, so Roy's got an opinion on this one. Roy Lisbon says, don't get the Ditto X3. Have memory issues in the second channel. Interesting. Okay. Now, I've never used a Ditto X4. Did I say X3? I meant X4. Never used one of those. I've used the Flashback X4, which I really like, and I quite like the looper in the Flashback X4, to be fair. But I am a simple soul. I don't do a whole lot of the live looping and layering kind of stuff. So I just like this guy. This is a Boss RC1. It is the most basic of Boss loop stations. I'll do the thing that people do on tech channels, and I'll do that. And look at that. It focuses on the product and not my face. You can tell I have a Sony camera because Sony cameras do that very well. So yeah, I like these. Excuse the dust. This is the one they use in all my reviews when I'm doing the looper tour thing. Nice and easy to use. That's basically it. Sounds good. Yeah, not much more to it. So that's what I like about that. Let's address Philippe's question. Philippe says, how can we practice natural harmonics and integrate them into an improvisation? Interesting. Well, the first question... Ah, interesting. Mark McNish has said Nux loop core works really well. I have a soft spot for Nux pedals. I really don't mind them at all. They get a bit of a bad rap, but I've had nothing but good success with particularly the Atlantic. I use it on my pedal board quite a lot. So yeah, especially from traveling, because I feel like I'm not going to be too upset if something bad happens to my Nux Atlantic. But if something happens to my Timeline and Big Sky, I'm going to be very, very cross. Especially if it's a gig where I just need a little bit of just general reverb and general delay. Anyway, so Philippe says, how can we practice natural harmonics and integrate them into an improvisation? Well, first thing to do, Philippe, is to establish the notes that your natural harmonics will produce. So for argument's sake, let's take some of my little favorite clusters. So there's a little cluster here. I'm going to go to a slightly wetter clean tone for this. Little cluster right here. That's maybe a little quiet. Just turn my clean up a little bit. That's better. Little cluster of notes here. Little cluster of notes here. A little cluster of notes here that give me a sus4. And a triad. So what I'm dealing with here are the notes A, D, and G. And then here I'm getting the notes A, D, F sharp, which is a lovely little cluster of notes for creating some arpeggio ideas. But here, I get another sus4. And then down here, all manner of stuff. So what I might do is I might take a look and see if I can find a track where all of these notes worked quite well. And E minor seems to work quite well for them. So you'll find a lot of these guys who are doing these kind of crazy, it's all stuff that sounds like... And then some ludicrous shreddy thing. You hear guys doing all that sort of stuff. A lot of the times they're playing in some derivative of E minor because natural harmonics in the guitar work quite well in E minor. Reason for this is because, incidentally, if you play all of the notes here, gives you an E minor 11. Play all the notes here, gives you B minor 11. Here we have an E minor 11 again. So if we take those two chords and put them together, E minor 11, and then we take a B minor 11, fundamentally sums to E Dorian or B minor. They both work, but we have an open E string, so. So what I might do is I might throw on something like the, do I have something in E minor? Ooh, I have the modern prog ballad in E minor. So I'll throw that on. What I might do is I might start with my clean sound and play just natural harmonics. Is it an E? And look for melodies. I'm looking for things. Start looking for little phrases where I contrast the natural harmonic against the some fretted notes. So maybe I might play. Some dirt. Let's throw some big delay on. Yeah. Probably something I need a bit more practice on. So that might be a way that you might approach that, but yeah, definitely something you can do just by, again, structuring your improvisation in such a way that it features natural harmonics a little bit more prominently. But I feel like knowing what notes you have probably help. So let's do some more questions, more questions. Had some real good ones. Are you a Tube Screamer fan? I quite like oh no, pulling my boards to bits. This one, it's a Mini Tube Screamer. Quite like that one because, to be completely honest, not really. I don't really use Tube Screamers too much myself. I like them, like the sound of them, don't really use them too much because I get a lot of gain from the amp. I'm using a Super Kraken, tons of gain. I do like my Cocoa Boost quite a lot, which has the similar frequency boost when I use it, at least. I use it on the lower mid setting. It has a similar 500 Hz boost to a Tube Screamer, but without the compression. However, I like this one because when you're reviewing amps, everybody wants to know what the amp sounds like with the Tube Screamer, either in the classic bluesman setting or the classic metal setting, like this, one or two other. So people want to know about that stuff, and it's tiny, which is pretty cool. So I like that one. Probably my favorite screamer, I guess, if you want to go down that road, is the Laney Monolith. Very, very underrated screamer, the Black Country Customs Monolith. I actually have it just off camera. Bear with me a second. Ooh. Strain and grab this. Black Country Customs Monolith. Like this quite a lot. That does the good screamer thing on the middle position, which is the overdrive setting. And what that gives you is, excuse the dust, it gives you, there we go, Black Country Customs Monolith. It gives you this kind of range control where you can kind of like dial out some low end, which I'm into. So that's pretty cool. They're my favorite Tube Screamers. I wouldn't say I'm necessarily a fan. More of a fuzz kind of guy if I'm going to use pedals, if I'm honest. My board, my large board anyway, has no less than 4 different fuzzes on it. I've got a Green Ringer clone. I have like a Muff type fuzz. I've got a Tone Bender type fuzz. And then I've got this really spitty gatey thing that I use for special effects. So anyway, let's keep going. Now, Philippe has another question, which is a very good one. Is there a good exercise to end practice time to relax fingers, muscle, and playing the guitar? Yeah, I think there is. I think probably a real nice exercise to finish on is playing some chords. This is something that Frank Gambale puts in Chop Builder at the end, playing some chords. And it's something we don't do a whole lot of. Now, the reason chords are cool is because they, by definition, unless you are some kind of super wizard, definition have to be played a little slower than your big, mad, like shred lines or whatever it is. You're not bending either, so we're not introducing tension at the forearm by bending or any of that good stuff. So what we might do is you might play something that I think of as maybe a ninth chord relay. If you didn't have any like specific goals, you might just relay through some ninth chords. So what I mean by that is you might play a major nine, a dominant nine, a minor nine, and then you might try just kind of relaying between those. So major nine, dominant nine, minor nine, major nine, dominant nine, minor nine, major, dominant, minor, major, dominant, minor. Very relaxing, has this lovely, pleasing sound. It's a little challenging, but it's not super challenging. And this little kind of like descending thing it's got going on, I'm a big fan of that. You could play going up, so you could start like this. Nice way to do things. Yeah, so I would probably do that. That's an interesting thing. Here we go. Roy's got another tip on looping that I want to share with you guys. If looping is for practice at home, just use Audacity. Yeah, absolutely. Just use Audacity. Audacity is a free download, free audio software. Just record something into there and you can loop it. Or if you have GarageBand, you have Logic, throw it on there. That's generally what I'll tend to do if I'm practicing at home, to be completely honest. I'll just knock a track together quickly in Logic, just like a 4-bar chord loop or something. In actual fact, a lot of the backing tracks that you guys get on the GI YouTube channel start life that way. Just be something that I'll put together to practice over, and I'll go, hey, that's cool, I like that. So one more question right at the top. I promised I would answer this one. Blue Sumlin, please help me with harmonizing a scale in E and the diminished triads. Oh, that's a big question. So harmonizing scales in E, let's see if we can do this in 2 minutes. So harmonizing scales, I guess what you mean is, we can take this two ways. We can take it from the perspective of the Thin Lizzy harmonizer. Whatever that would be. Wow, that was a good guess. Yeah, it could be that thing, or it could be the idea of harmonizing, as in playing the chords of a scale. And the way diminished triads relate to that. So let's start with that one. So the idea of playing a harmonized major scale. So a scale in C, major scale in C, we have the notes of my major scale. Each note has a chord type you can attach to it. If we just do basic triad chords, we get major, minor, minor, major, major, minor, diminished, which is its own thing. So there's the diminished triad in and of itself, but the diminished triad will crop up later. So major, minor, minor, major, major, minor. Interesting. Diminished. If we start to expand these out into sevenths, we get major seven, minor seven, minor seven, major seven, dominant seven, minor seven. Now, dominant seven is interesting. It's where the term dominant seven comes from. It's the seven that naturally occurs on what was referred to in 19th century musical parlance as the dominant degree of the scale. 5-1, or the country bass line. Interesting enough, by the way, very quickly, if you take that idea of the country bass line, you make it minor, suddenly we have traditional Jewish European music. Just saying, American music, cultural melting pot. Anyway, and if you may put it in a tuba, it's German Oompa. Totally fascinating in and of itself, but we're getting off track. So, our diminished triad, in this sense, can be a passing chord that we can use basically in between any of our chord, our diatonic chords, let's say. And what you can do is you can use the diminished triad to lead from one chord to another, usually in an ascending direction, but it doesn't have to be. So an example of this might be leading between, let's say, chord one and chord two in a pleasing way. What you can do is throw in a diminished triad or a diminished seventh chord, which also works, on the note in between these two chords. This is not the only place you can do it, but it's definitely something you can do. So, cool way to get into this idea is to take major 7 on, in this case, C. We're going to minor 7 on D. Doesn't matter what we're going to. We'll just throw a diminished 7 on the note in between, which is C sharp or D flat, however you want to look at it. What about going from D to E? Well, there's a note in between. Let's throw a diminished chord in there. And that's quite good fun. And you can do this in your soloing too. So you can throw in a little in-between note. So on. It sounds quite good fun. It's quite a nice thing to do. So that's kind of what I'm thinking we're talking about there. The Thin Lizzy thing, that's as simple as playing the same melodic contour, but starting two notes up the scale. So if the scale is this, we have a scale line that goes. We start a couple of notes up. There's our harmony. Ooh, do it again. There are, however, some considerations when it comes to, certainly in the major scale, what you do with the fourth and what you do with the fifth. And that depends on what chord, the fourth and what you do with the seventh. Depends what chord you're playing over. So if you're playing over a G chord, you might throw the seventh in. So you might go, you might go there. And if you're playing over a C chord, you might miss that seventh out at the top and just play the root instead, so your harmony becomes. So you get this. Definitely something to consider. And likewise, fourths, you may not play the fourth if you had a line that went like this. Oh, let's say. You want to harmonize like this. Depending upon what you're playing over, you may go. Or you may go. You notice I'm missing out that fourth. Fifth instead. A whistle stop tour of harmonization in the major scale. It's a big topic. Certainly can't hope to cover it in 2 minutes. It took me 6 and we still didn't cover it. So there you go. That is a little something on harmonizing the major scale. Guys, thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure. Tell you what I'm going to do. We're going to do that solo and I'm going to play you out and we're going to go between tone A and tone B. And let's see which one you guys like first. I'm going to start with tone A and I will alert you to when I have changed. In case you're wondering, the only thing that's changing the signal chain is the impulse response. So, just throwing that out there. Let's throw a backing track on. Let's do the blues rock and C, because I'm really feeling this one today. I've been missing playing some blues rock. So I'm going to chuck this on. We're going to start with tone A, then move to tone B. You guys tell me in the comments as we go which one you enjoy the most. Here we go, tone A first. Oh, by the way, my name is Nick Jennison for GI. I'll see you next time. Here we go. Tone A. Here comes tone B. Here comes Tony again. Looks like the jury is in. Tone B sounds. Tone A sounds a little muddy compared to B. Well, there you go. If you have it, I'm going to play you guys out on Tone B. Let's do it. My name's Nick Jennison. I'll see you guys later. Oh, Matt's coming with a lay-fo for Tone A. Tone A definitely feels nicer, but that's not necessarily what it's about. So, hey, keep them votes coming in, but I'm going to play you out in Tone B. Here we go. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.